Good morning. Today we are starting the class of compiler construction. This is the first simplest block of compiler, but later days maybe it will be interpreter also. But nowadays the languages are like Python, they are mostly interpreter, and day by day the interpreter based language is coming. And today the 16th of December, but it is an online class. But those who are there, anytime they can make a microphone on and ask the question. That is a more interactive class that you would like. So this is the most interesting thing is a source program, and there is a target program which can be run on any target machine, or it can be run on a virtual machine like Python virtual machine, Java virtual machine. So this, and this in the compiler, the single box, there are lots of technologies are there. In fact, most advanced computer science programming techniques, from machine learning, artificial intelligence, data structure, dynamic programming, you name it, you will get it. So this is the highest, most sophisticated, other than operating system, I think the most sophisticated system. Okay, so where we are, so this is the compiler, this is the highest kind of software other than OS. So lot of technologies can be learned, and that can be used from any other to other technology. That is one of the reason you should learn compiler, because it is the basic foundations of the computer science other than automata theory and data structure. That is the reason I like compiler. And let's see what else can be done. You can ask question. Next slide. If you take the there is a compiler, there are various stages, and we'll show you for different diagrams from different textbooks. But mainly compiler or interpreter has two main phase. One is analysis phase, what the codes are being analyzed and come to intermediate code, and intermediate code is very vital, and then it will go to synthesis for the target machine code. From this intermediate code, you can run it from any other machine, say maybe on any virtual machine. But if you want to go for any target code, you can go for any machine specific target code. So there were two types of machine code. One is the actual target machine code, another is intermediate code, and both cases optimization is done. And in analysis portion, the first portion is very simplistic portion, that is called lexical analysis. I will go into detail. Then comes very interesting course is the parsing. That is one of the interesting subjects, and lots of questions comes and parsing. There are two type of parsing. One is top down parsing, that is you start from S, that is start symbol, and try to match to the left. That is called top down parsing, sometimes called LL parsing, start from L and left hand side rule. And another is more powerful is bottom up parsing, that is it is LR, it is from right side you will try to match and go to the S. So here you from try to bottom, make it the right side symbol, reduce, shift or reduce, and try to reach the S. And other is from top down, you start from S, you try to match the leftmost terminal and try to match the whole string. So top down you will take first, because top down will invent certain techniques that you will use in bottom up, that is LR. LL is top down, mainly LL1 is a top down, and lot of technique we learn from LL1 will go to LR. So anyway, this is the first stage is analysis portion. The first stage is I wish to tell you again, that is lexical analysis, then comes the parsing, and then comes the semantic analysis, and then comes the intermediate code generation. Okay, so this is analysis portion and synthesis portion. Lots of these are all basically stages, sometimes called phases. We'll see to it. Yeah, this is another interesting diagram I wish to take. This is all, these are all taken from famous textbooks. There's a standard textbooks, Aho's book and other books. There it says that the lexical analysis, this is the stage, and sometimes it is called scanner, so you should not be confused, both is the same. And sometimes you see the term lexemes. Lexemes are tokens, are almost equivalent, but token is the more prevalent word. So what is the first stage of whenever you write a source program into it, they taken out the tokens. What are the tokens like? Int I equal to 1. Int is a token, is a keyword. I is a variable token. Equal to is a variable token. Even 1 is a token. Semicolon is a token. I am taking an example of a single sentence in C language. So it is basically token, and this token that's stored, there is another called is a symbol table. A symbol table is a data structure. It can be maintained. Preferably, it is generally maintained by hash table, but it can be array also. The symbol table, all the definitions of the variables, functions are written onto it, and they are not only that, in all phases of compiler, they are looked into it, and we'll come to that symbol table. But this is one interesting. This is scanner, sometimes called lexical analysis, I've told, and this is simply done. Is input is automata is automata use here is the finite state machine. Why? Because they are only taken the tokens from the programming language. They taken out the comment line, they taken out white spaces, they only the tokens, the meaningful tokens, and they are taken out. So this is the main job of lexical analysis. Even the finite state machine with the regular expression of variable, integer, that is enough. So there is no use of using any other sophisticated machine. Then the token is filled up, then we'll go for the parsing. Parsing is the, we try to guess how these sets of terminals, whenever it will come with a sequence of tokens, then how the sequence of tokens can come from the rules of the language. The rules of the parser is a program. We'll try to get it the tree, and that is called a parsing tree. But this parsing tree is verbose, so we'll go for the abstract syntax tree. Is a much more compact than parsing tree. We'll go to it. And there are the two techniques. One is two main techniques are there. One is top-down parsing. Top-down parsing. There are several 2-3 techniques, but LL1 is the best one. That is LL1 technique, and another is bottom-up. That is LR1 is the best one. We'll cover this two in the later classes, but we can do this. It's a compiler block diagram in one way. Let's go to the next slide. This is the book I'll follow, because there is exam is not nearby. So if you wish to learn the compiler, this is the best book. All teachers follow this book, and the soft copies I'll make available. All our books are available, soft copies. Yes, and I have several soft copies of several books. I'll share with you. Yeah, this is the simplest program of compiler. It is I wish to give the compiler for different version, but here also I mentioned it can be interpreted as well. Yeah, just quick recollection of our context free grammar. First of all, why you go for context free grammar? Because you know the regular grammar, the problem is you cannot make repeated function call, that is, you cannot make opening bracket and closing bracket matches. That is the negative thing of regular grammar. Regular grammar will is a memory, but that memory doesn't matches the number of opening braces and closing braces. If that is not there, you cannot make a function call and come back to the function call. So for any procedural programming, you need a context-free grammar. That is the main reason why you are going for context-free grammar. Reason is that context-free grammar is essential for procedural-oriented programming. Procedural-oriented programming means you call function and return function. You need opening braces and matching closing braces. That is one of the reason the context-free grammar is needed. And another is if-then-else structure. You sometimes have if-then-else and then if-then, and it can be built in built. If-then can be there in if-then-else, and else is matches the nearest then. We call the dangling else problem. If then else, it may contain any number of ifs, any number of else, and then the nearest else and then will matching. So if that kind of language, you cannot handle to regular grammar. You know the regular language rules are there. Variable can be on the right hand side, that is called right linear grammar, or on the left side, left linear grammar. So next is the context free grammar. Context free grammar is a or context free language, a huge area. That is mainly two categories are there. One is non-deterministic context-free grammar or language, non-deterministic context-free grammar, deterministic context free grammar or language. It is be shown the non deterministic context free grammar or language is very, very powerful, but is too difficult to implement in hardware. So forget about it, because non-determinism here is not like your in your regular machine where is the power is same, but only non-determinism give you fewer state. That is no use basically. That is only non-deterministic finite state machine is used for simplifying the regular expressions. Otherwise, no use, I feel. So, but in the context-free grammar, say palindrome is a non-deterministic context-free grammar. Even palindrome, odd palindrome, or any palindrome. So, it is very powerful. It is. You see, nowadays in virus detection, or if you go for any RNA, DNA, there is always a palindrome syndrome is there. So, palindrome is very, very powerful data structure, but it is not, it cannot be done by a deterministic context free grammar. Deterministic context free grammar means a to the power n, b to the power n type of thing, and matching open braces, closing braces. All programming languages, 99% of the programming languages constructed by deterministic context free grammar. Why? Because deterministic context free grammar can be deterministically parsed in O(n) time by this rule. Okay, I repeat one second. Why you will go for context-free grammar? With context-free grammar, we go for because our regular language cannot handle the repeated function calls, because closing braces, opening braces, matching, it is not possible. Regular grammar or finite state machine are equivalent. Finite state machine cannot remember a to the power n, b to the power n. It cannot detect the how many braces are opening, how many closings. And another is you need if then else structure. Both these things cannot be handled by regular grammar, but it has can be handled by context free grammar. Context free grammar mainly two divisions. One is deterministic context free grammar, like a to the power n, b to the power n grammar, or balanced parenthesis grammar. These are very deterministic, and the rules are deterministic context free grammar. Language is deterministic context free language. I know you know little you got understanding between what is the difference between language and grammar. A language can have many grammar. But a grammar can give only one language. A language maybe have 10 grammars, 9 of them are ambiguous, 1 is unambiguous, then I will say the language is unambiguous with that grammar. So a language can have many grammar, it can have 10 grammar, 9 grammar may be ambiguous, and 1 is unambiguous, then we say language is unambiguous with that grammar. Okay, that's it. That is the relation between grammar and language. But coming back to this, deterministic a to the power n, b to the power n, and balanced parenthesis, they can be done by deterministic context free grammar, and you can have deterministic context free grammar for it. Then you might ask, why not non-deterministic context free grammar? Very useful thing is palindrome, odd palindrome, even palindrome, and that is very naturalistic thing, that palindrome is the part of life. If you see our DNA matching and all this, our DNA you see here now in the corridor of finance and all these things, there's always a palindrome match is there, but palindrome to matching hardware is very difficult. Again, non-deterministic pushdown automata is very tough. That means you have to replicate 2 to the power n, and if one of them goes yes, then it accept. But it is not right now. Say not possible, but quantum computing is coming and all these things, might be one day it is possible. But these languages, whatever we are studying, the parsing, we are for deterministic context free grammar with unambiguous deterministic context free language with unambiguous grammar. Even unambiguous grammar, there are separations for this. Any questions, Shomo, and any others, please?
Explain that. I have some confusions in deterministic and non-deterministic context-free grammar.
Very good. The confusion, deterministic context-free grammar and non-deterministic context-free grammar, it is better if we think of language, okay, strings, okay, strings. You think that two representative screen languages, a to the power n, b to the power n, and another is a palindrome. Okay, so a to the power n, b to the power n, you always visualize a imaginary stack. When a to the power n is coming, you push them into the stack. When each b is coming, you pop one a and take out. And whenever you end up the string, your stack is finished. So all grammar, say a to the down, a to the power n, b to the power 2n, same thing. For every 2b, you pop 1a, okay? Or a to the power 2n, b to the power n. So you push 2a's, and for every b, you pop 2a. So any relation between, so what I want to say, any relation between a and b, integer relation, that can be handled by deterministic push down automata. Somoy, you understood it?
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
Good. Now coming back to palindrome. Say a palindrome, say a b b b b a. So this is a palindrome, but you see the midpoint is after a b b b, a b b you push and b b a you pop. But you can visualize it. The computer is stupid. Computer cannot understand. So what they do for detecting this a b b b b a, this is a palindrome, they replicate the machines. So a you push a and another both first you all push, then next b you push and another you pop a. So right, if you have a plethora of machines, if you have a number of machines, so one machine definitely follow a b b, push a, push b, push b, push and b b a, pop b, pop b, pop a. The input string is matched, stack is empty. So but you have to replicate, you don't know where is the midpoint is, okay? So you have to replicate it many push down automatas. One of them will satisfy, then we'll say yes, this is a non-deterministic push down automata which takes up the palindrome grammar. Palindrome grammar is a representative grammar for non-deterministic context-free grammar. But here, to realize this hardware, then so many number of push down machines in the actual VLSI, it's too difficult, okay? So that is the call. We generally do not use non-deterministic context-free grammar in our programming languages. Any question, please? This is main difference, no other difference. Yes. Have you got it, Shomo?
Yes, about it.
So that again, question is that deterministic context-free grammar means you always a to the power n, b to the power n, and the balance parenthesis grammar. These two representative grammar, opening braces, closing braces matches. And non-deterministic context-free grammar example is palindrome grammar. And another same, some books say W comma WR, that is called even palindrome, and that's it. But if the palindrome is separated by a hash character, then it is a deterministic context free grammar. Say W hash WR, W hash WR. Then you know this hash is the midpoint, so you push W and pop WR. So that is a deterministic context free grammar. But if you taken out this hash WWR, this is a non-deterministic context free grammar. So W hash WR is a is a deterministic context-free grammar, but you take out hash, then you have to guess every point then my reverse string is coming. So one of them is definitely matches, so that's it, okay? But it can be easily solved by Turing machine, easily, that we know the Turing machine can solve, but we are thinking of the push-down automata, okay? So that's it. Good question. So this is, you know, all this thing grammar, some books it is say V for variables, and sub books say non-terminals. Both are there. P production rules, sigma alphabet, S is the start symbol. Yeah, it is done. This is same. Some other books say V variable, terminal, P sets of production. In fact, all grammars have this same kinds of things. Only rules are different. All grammar have these four tuples. Only rules are different. P is the different. Yeah, regular expression, regular language you all know, so I'm not going to detail. Next slide. So regular expression, see, this is very interesting thing, that any variable, see, it is what I do is here, integer, how the integer, by regular expression. It will be integer, if it is not digit, so it is not integer, if integer is coming, is not digit, is not integer. So whenever in lexical analysis stage, you have a regular expression to catch any integer, if it if it abides this, then you say it's an integer. Otherwise, it is not an integer. So that is a regular expression for integer detection. Same way, a regular expression for variables, floating point numbers, integer, everything can be made. Array declaration, so it can be all done by regular expression. And so that the first stage of compiler is a lexical analyzer. I repeatedly told, lexical analyzer is a very simple thing. It's nothing but a deterministic finite state machine with lots of regular expressions of integer, character, variable, and they just make tokens out of the your source string, taking out the comment lines and the white spaces. It creates a token and fill that the tokens with a symbol table. Each row given to a variable, and what is the scope, what is the type, integer, float, char, what is the scope of these, even all the function names will be there in symbol table. Symbol table is very vital. We'll see to it. Yeah. This is a lexical analysis. Some books a scanner generator, so both are same. But lexical is a more popular name, and you sometimes get the name Lexim. Lexim comes before it is tokenized, but after it is output is lexical analysis output is token, series of tokens, and filled it up appropriately in the symbol table. The next stage, the strings come. The lexical analysis gives the any program, it is set up a sentence, and the next in parsing is to take the sentence, and you have the rules of the programming languages. You try to get, say, parse tree, and that parse should be, it can be done by top down or bottom up, but the it should be unique. Parse tree should be unique, and we call it in compiler analysis, it is called abstract syntax tree. It's a subtle difference between abstract syntax tree and parse tree. Parse tree generally maintain all leaf nodes and everything. Abstract syntax tree only meant relevant things, which much shorter in to store. We'll see to it. This is abstract syntax tree. But if you get your parse tree okay, then you are syntactically your program correct. Then comes the semantic phase, the meaning of this, whether you have put integer into integer or float into integer, or you have null variable be assigned to somebody. All these logical issues will be, semantic reason will be checked by the semantic analysis. That is pretty simple, but the toughest portion is here, is the parsing. Yeah. Yes, great, fine. So that's it. So here is another example from famous book. You see here, symbol table is basically a repository. Your program comes to it, lexical analyzer or some lexical analyzer makes into tokens get into parser, it is a series of tokens, and the information of tokens in symbol table. This data structure, how to maintain the symbol table, is a very interesting thing. You generally nowadays maintain hash table, maybe not one hash table, one or two hash table, because hash table is performance is good. It can be maintained in array, it can be maintained in tree, any lookup thing, and it can be maintained in dictionary, like in Python, in a dictionary. Dictionary is basically nothing but a hash table. That is, symbol table is interesting. And then this is parse tree or abstract syntax tree, and the rest of the front. This whole portion is analysis. This is intermediate code generation. Then comes the code, actual machine of code generation, that is called synthesis. The machine learning and all these things can be used there, because nowadays compiler technology is one of the best. I already told you, maybe complexity wise is next only to operating system, because nowadays hardwares are varying, and you have to run in virtual machines, and the programming also less code, so you have to match this, and so that's it. The compiler is on the sophisticated technology. Yes. This is a lexical tokens. See here, this ID, number, real, if. These are all left parenthesis. These are the tokens are maintained in languages. Comment in C language. This is a comment. Preprocessor. These are all defined. Preprocessor, macro. So like in the C language, everything is given. In the lexical analysis is intelligent enough to know this is a preprocessor, this is this, that's it. Yeah, this is the I have told you the regular expressions used by the lexical analysis to catch, say, keyword like if, id, num, white space, error. These are all the standard regular expressions. This is, I have told you, the symbol table. This is the symbol table, and this is lexical analysis. Then comes the syntax analysis or parsing, top down or bottom up. Semantics is easier, intermediate consideration. The symbol table, it is filled up by the lexical analysis phase and it is used. And everywhere, we also know in lexical analysis there might be errors. How to handle error? Because when the error comes, it should come out of the compiler. It should give error, meaningful error description, not only one at a time error. There may be one or two error or three errors should be reported so that programmer can be. So error handling is also great concern. Which error, in which order, lexical analysis, syntax analysis, and if the error comes, not immediately get it out by panicking. The compiler, right, it is such a sophisticated way, it sometimes it will help you to debug why the error is coming, try to sometimes correct you. So all these things is the part of the error handler. So error handler comes to all this software. These are nothing but a software modules. Yeah, I have already covered lexical analysis, syntax analysis, semantic analysis. These are the another lexical, parse, semantic. This is more detailed. This is the symbol table. This is the function. This is the symbol table. It's just this data structure, name and symbol. That's it. Yeah. Another way, look at it, lexical, syntax, symbol table is heart of the thing. Yeah, I think let's go. This I have already covered. This you know, this is a type C grammar. We are not programming language cannot be part of the thing. Is programming language is regular type C grammar, like declaration of variable, integer. This definitely regular. But whenever you are making a program with a function call, then you need opening braces and closing braces. Number of closing, opening and closing should be matched. So you need a context free grammar, and deterministic context free grammar is needed because the hardware is not cannot handle non-determinism. So that's it. Here I'll come to this. They have covered. Here is important things. In a regular languages, whenever you have n terminals are there, to get it by which rules it comes, it will take only linear. But in context free grammar, it is O n to the O n cube. If n is a number of terminals and the parsing is O n cube. But the main compiler's thing is that we should try to O n, not try, we must make it O n. O n cube means if your 10 lines program takes 10 minutes, 1000 line programs may take 10 to the power 6 or 9. Okay, so it cannot be n cube. So it should be 10 lines programs take 10 minutes, 100 line programs say 100 minutes. That's okay. But no compiler take 10 minutes, say 10 line programs say 10 seconds. So that's a good example. 10 line program say 10 seconds, 100 line program take 100 seconds. That's okay. We agree. But it cannot take 100 line programs, cannot be 10 to the power 100. That cannot be there. That is exponential. Even 1000, 10 line, 10 minutes program take 10 seconds programs, 10 line, 10 seconds, 100 lines, 100 seconds. That is okay. That is linear relationship. But cannot be even 100,000, cannot be 10,000. That is it. So all what is our compiler, we try to make a grammar, unambiguous grammar through deterministic context free grammar. The parsing should be ON, so it should be linear. So it should be like this. Why we are not going for more higher grammar, like context sensitive grammar, like whenever you get A to the power N, B to the power N, C to the power N, or WW language, because that is exponential. It could be 2 to the power n. Okay, so parsing will be there. So though it is a sophisticated, but we do not have that kind of hardware. Maybe quantum computing comes, then we can do this. But our target should be, it should be ON. Yeah. This is already covered. This is another way. Same thing. Some books say scanner, some book the laser. This is scanner generator, some lexical analysis, laser. But ultimately, token is the final keyword. It should go to the symbol table, and this is the serial combination of tokens which go to the parser. Parser should get the abstract syntax tree or the tree. Yeah. Yes, it is already covered. This is interesting diagram. This is hopped-up bookings there. I follow this diagram very much. Let's go details. This is lexical analysis here. See, this is a program a statement. The lexical analysis make it a all variables to make a token. Okay, this is the token, and the all these token values ID1, ID2, ID3, the symbol table. So you can have a many big variable name, but ultimately that will be give a token ID1, ID2, and it is stored there. The syntax analysis that is parsing, it will create this. This is called the abstract syntax tree. Here the operation and here the operand. This is little different of parsing tree. This is basically abstract syntax tree. Yeah, here it is the your operand, and this operator. This is operator, and this is the leaf is the operand. Okay, this is operator. Okay, so this diagram you get it hopped up. Yeah, this is another way. Same thing. I am not going to detail. You will get it in books. Same thing. You will get in the books. Get in the books. Almost same thing. I have already covered. I wish to mention. This is a program line. And this is lexical analyzer. This is nothing but deterministic finite state machine. And these are the tokens. So any big name, and it converted to token. And this is called abstract syntax tree or parse tree. The more equivalent abstract syntax tree, it is very compact. It can be saved like this kind of pointer architecture. You know, you how to make this kind of through pointed. You can makes this like a tree concept. Difficult to understand deterministic context free grammar and non-deterministic context free grammar. You should always think in mind a simple push down automata. If a simple push down automata can recognize your language, that is a deterministic context free language, a deterministic context free grammar. But if you cannot design a single push down automata, but if you have you need a multiple push down automata to recognize your language, then it is called non-deterministic context-free grammar or non-deterministic context-free language. Okay, that's a good question. Let's go ahead.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, let's go ahead. Lexical analyzer. This I have covered. Token. I think here this is important. This is how the token beginning. This is a input buffer, and the token beginning. And if they matches any regular expression, they got it a token. Otherwise, not. This is a pointer. This is a simple program. It takes the token beginning. I'll give an example. This Lexeme name is informal. Tokens whenever it is finalized, removing white spaces. I have told you. I just give an example. Too much animation here. This is. Can you tell me how many time tokens are there? Just let me count. This is int is one token. This whole thing is one token. Let's see it. Comment will be removed. These are the tokens coming. This is not slightly visible because it's a yellow. This is comes as 25. I'm sorry for this. I'll correct it to the actual paper. The number of tokens, int is one token, max is one token, this opening braces is one token, x is one token, comma is one token, y is one token, this is closing brace is one token. Number of 7 tokens are there. This is again int is one token because it is a serial. X is one token, 9th, comma, Y. So these comments will be, these comments will be removed. This is one token. This is one token. The return is one token. This the opening braces is one token. This is X is one token. Total number of tokens is 25. Is it a bit understandable to you, or should I make white? Why yellow should be more brighter? Yes, it is understandable.
No, sir. Yes, yes, sir.
Okay, I'll do it. Okay. Thank you. Sorry for this. This is a question from Gate. Yeah, this is how many tokens will be there? So this is an interesting. So this is the say example. This is a statement printf. This interesting thing is this whole this string is one token. This is a third token. See, the whole string is one token. The printf is one token is a function. This is one token. This is one token. This is one token. No, not token. This whole this thing is a token. Then semicolon is fourth token. And then I is a fifth token. Semicolon 6 token, the total token is semicolon is comma 10. So the answer is C. Is this understandable, everyone, please? The catch is there. This string is a one token only. This is the catch. You should not go into the screen. Okay. So this whole string is one token. Third token. Okay. So this is very vital. Very good. Correct option. This is a formal. This is a basically Fortran language. Because whenever we study, then we study first the Fortran language. This is a Fortran language. So do is the for loop there. The number of tokens is 5. Okay, so good. Thank you all. And give any